Life is made of great moments, and a birth is a great moment, and there's other great moments during your lifetime, and this being another great moment that I truly look forward to. It's been a long time coming, and I'm delighted that it's taking place, and I'm delighted to welcome Sam and her family to joining our family, and thinking about this, as long as you think about this, God Almighty, I could, you know, 37 years of raising Christopher and other things, you're never ready for something like this. It just, I tried writing, I tried this, it is what it is. But there have been moments in our lifetime, and you raise a son, and part of what you don't expect is to gain a best friend, and we've been at this a long time, and I just wanted to, there's a couple moments that came to mind. Not long ago, someone I'm working for took me to a Rangers playoff game when they're in the Stanley Cup deal, and I remember taking Christopher to Madison Square Garden, and it's on top of taking in all the extravaganza of the place, the game ensued, and during the game, a couple had a dispute that escalated to beers being thrown, that escalated to security coming, escalated into a brawl, and bodies starting to tumble down the seats where we were sitting, and poor Christopher is underneath the seat, and people are coming down the thing, and like, Dad. So they finally get all these bodies out of the place, and he gets up, and I said, "Well, Christopher, you have seen it all. You've got the whole deal, the game, the fight, the whole thing, and away we go." We've lived through broken necks, we've lived through 9/11, and the event of him making the decision to move here, which all I can say is if you can make it work, your life will be great. It'll be healthier, happier, everything about it. I think that's happened. I'm delighted, and further, I'm delighted with all these friends of his that he spent time with, went to school with. I'm humbled by how successful and how great people they have turned out to be in life. That's part of what you do in raising people. It's hopefully become successful, that they have integrity, that they have character. All of these people exemplify this like tenfold. I'm delighted at this event, and I will finish by saying that there's a song that the Eagles sing, Don Henley, Desperado. Every time I hear it, it sort of chronicles Christopher's adult life with many of the phrases, and if you have the opportunity, you could listen to it, read the words, but it ends with a line that, better let somebody love you before it's too late. You have, I'm glad. Cheers with my heart to all of you. Thank you.
All right. So I don't think anyone wanted to follow Mr. Ludwig, so I'll do it. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Ben Ireland. I had the pleasure of going to high school with Chris, going to college with Chris, and being a friend with him since then. I wanted to share sort of my experiences that I remember with Chris. High school, he was this shorter guy, big chip on the shoulder, drove a car called the Penny Racer. I don't know if you remember those. We put the penny in the back, and it would pop up, hit this little white thing. And that's sort of a running theme in my experience with Chris. It felt like every time you saw him, you'd be driving a new car. It would be, went from the penny racer to a truck, to the bourbon, to a different truck. You'd see him 6 months later, it'd be a new truck. I don't know what you're driving now or how many cars you've had out here in Jackson, but I'm sure it's not one. Didn't you have a motorcycle at one time?
Yeah.
Chris was always sort of very handy. He's somebody that would always get a call, hey, I need a shelf hung, what do I do? I'm not a handy person, Chris is. He's always my first call when I have something to figure out, and normally he will tell me and I can't figure it out, so I have to pay somebody else to do it. If he's around, he'll drive. The great thing about Chris is he'll drive up and you know, kind of come help you at a moment's notice. He's always been a very loyal friend, thick and thin. I remember several fights that I was a part of where he would come charging in, and it didn't matter how many people were there, he would be coming in, fist blazing, mouth running, and you know, often to change the time. So Samantha, just in case, you got a bulldog on your back. You know, the fun thing with Chris is he's basically a brother. He's a big part of the family. He's someone, however you know him, whether it's Chris, Luds, Wiggs, Wigger, Wigglesworth, Wiggles. I know everyone's got sort of nicknames for him, but he's someone that's, you know, been a part of our lives. My parents are here this weekend. He's someone that, you know, I can't imagine going to school without you. We've been through some crazy times. My first hockey game was seeing Chris break his neck. So that was fun, but I also got to study with him with his halo. And just having him drink beers with a halo on and studying for our exams the next day. I don't know how successful we were, but we sure had a blast. And some of the guys we're studying with aren't here right now, but they are there. But, you know, kind of seeing him recover and become the person he is, you know, he's as fearless now as he was then. He's someone I draw a great bit of inspiration from, and I just remember getting the call from him. I guess it's, we just were talking about this over 4 years ago, being like, I think we're gonna move out to Jackson, what do you think? And you know, told him it was a no-brainer. I think you heard that probably from several people, and I'm thrilled you did it. I've never seen you happier, never seen you healthier. You're just, you know, you're gonna be great. And Samantha, I am happy you found Chris. You know, happy to give them to you. Mind to give. But, you know, he's a great friend and somebody I'm just thrilled that you guys are going to be together. So, congratulations. A toast to the couple.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Thanks for having us.
Hey,
guys. Sam and I met a little over 10 years ago. We were introduced through a mutual friend who insisted that we meet and was very confident that we would be great friends. And I'm truly grateful for that introduction and to that old friend of ours. Earlier this week, I was having a little anxiety about giving a toast, getting up for you all. So I shot Sam a text and I was like, so, I mean, is anything off limits? Anything you don't want me to say? Not anything you'd have the balls to say. This is my response. And I was like, classic. Sam. Brutally honest with her quick wit. And those are two things that I love about you so much. But some things that, or one thing that you all might not know about Sam, one thing that I love about you the most is your generosity. I can't, I guess early on in our friendship, Sam recognized one of my major weaknesses, and that's that I get, well, I guess through our friendship, she pointed out several of mine. Number one is that I can't cook anything, and I can't count the hundreds of meals over the last 10 years that you've cooked for me. And Chris, you know as well as I know how lucky you are. Sam makes the coffee, she makes the sandwiches, she cooks dinner, the refrigerator is always full and her door is always open. And I love you so much. I love you so much. But anyway, I guess my point is, when Chris came into the picture, and share Sam. And I'm glad that it's with you. I couldn't be happier for the two of you. Thanks for being such a great partner, Chris, Sam, and I wish you all the best. This is my sister. She sometimes looks like this. At any point in the day, you never know what you're going to get. But we haven't lived in the same town pretty much ever as grown ups, and I've been here almost 2 years, and we've become the best friends ever. And it's awesome, and I'm so thankful. And I'm thankful for Chris for marrying you. The first time I met Chris, I came out for a visit for 4th of July, like two years ago, and Sam was like, Chris is going to pick you up in Idaho Falls, which is a 2-hour car ride away, so it's like, you know, could be semi-awkward. Chris is super mellow and really quiet, as we know, and I was like, oh, I wonder who wears the pants in this. I think it's fair to say, like, if they were a car together, Sam's the accelerator, Chris is the brake. they complement each other so, so well, and they're so in love, and they're such good friends, and I could not be happier for you guys. I wish you all the happiness in the world, and may your children be as cool as Dexter.
But I'm one of Sam's bridesmaids, and I wrote a little something that I may read from, if that's okay. I met Sam 8 years ago on the back roads of Idaho, of all places, which is very ironic and funny to both of us, given how we both feel about Idaho, and given the fact that it would be just fine with us if we never visited that state again. Naturally, Sam was driving, and I ended up in the front seat, with the six other trailing minions cramming in the back, listening to us meet each other and jabber away. I'm pretty sure it took us about 2 minutes to realize we were a match made in friend heaven. I'm so grateful for that moment, as it brought me one of the best, most fun, loyal, supportive, and giving friends I have ever had. Somewhere over the next few years, after one of our breakups or another, Sam and I decided perhaps we should come up with a more solid life plan. A backup plan, if you will. We decided maybe should we never meet the suitable man for us, we would build ourselves a little New England white clappered home with black shutters and a front porch, raise little orphans that we got from where we thought we would get them, hang out in our bathrobes, drink coffee all day. Luckily, neither of us really like cats that much, so that wasn't really much of a concern for the porch. Thankfully for Sam and I and everyone else involved, quite honestly, Chris decided to move to town after many years of dipping his little toes in Jackson Hole. I believe it only took about a month for Sam and Chris to meet, at which point they were an instant hit. Sam called me and said, I met someone. And I said, who? And she said, Chris Ludwig. And I said, I know him. Being the wonderful, solid individuals they both are, they were a couple instantly. Perhaps a match made in actual relationship heaven. Sam met someone far more than just suitable for her. Sam and Chris are both very kind, loving, smart, giving, supportive, and fun. One of them is a total firecracker, and the other is very peacefully laid back, bringing a welcome balance to one another. I'm so grateful for Sam in my life, and I'm so grateful for Chris in her life. If I must give up my life partner, I'm glad it's to someone like Chris. Chris, thank you for making Sam so happy. Thank you for saving us from ourselves. The potential to live with many cats. Congratulations.
My name is Rachel Burks. I am one of Sam's friends and Chris's friends too, thank goodness. I met Sam several years ago when I was ski bumming here in Jackson Hole. Really strange to have a ski bum here. But when I say ski bumming, I was living on a floor next to four other guys, and it was pretty gross. And I remember meeting Sam at the bar. And the first thing I noticed about Sam was her eyes. Guys, these eyes right here are like, you see them and they're so bright and so blue and they're forever young and forever wise at the same time, you know? And the coolest part about those eyes is that I've found over the years, one of my favorite things about Sam and your fabulous eyes is that, you know, when you're throwing a stick for a dog and they're like, throw it again, throw it again, throw it again. Sam's eyes are like that, to laugh. They always want to laugh. She is more eager to laugh than anyone I've ever met. She can't wait to meet someone that's hilarious and great and fabulous, and she becomes instant friends. We were like instant friends. She actually informed me after I had chatted with her for about 5 minutes that I was going to be living with her now instead of living on the floor. And I was like, oh. She's like, I don't even have your last name. She's like, no. You will be living at my house with me, away from the gross boys, in a girl house with no gross boy things, you know? So I literally moved in the next day. I actually met Chris the very first night that Chris and Sam hung out, and Emery kind of said something about not being stoked about sharing. Well, I wasn't stoked about sharing Sam because I never got to see her anymore, and Sam really wasn't stoked about sharing me with me. So I'll let them tell the story later, but she basically boxed Chris out and was like, I'm talking to Rachel right now. So I ran into Chris and Sam a year later, and I fell in love with Chris when I was being loud and telling a story about someone crazy. And I was like, oh man, they're just crazy. And Chris goes, yeah, I know. I'm madly in love with one just like her. And I was like, oh, she's in. Because it's true, Sam, you're crazy is intoxicating. It is, and it's contagious, and I love your crazy, and I love being around you, and so does everyone else. It's like, just nonstop energy, and Chris, damn, dude, you guys are so cool together, and I will raft down that river and have you bike up and pick us up any day. But truthfully, so happy, so proud of you guys. You guys are great together, and I can't wait throw back some beers later on at the Cowboy Bar and give you some more hugs. So thank you.
Ludwig and I went to college together, along with a couple other people in this room. Go Saints! But I might be the reason that Ludwig is in this town. I'm honestly not sure as well if I'm deserving of the finale. I'm a little nervous. I probably should have written something down, but I didn't. So I'm just going to wing it a little bit. Ludwig and I were fraternity brothers in college, and we shared a common interest with skiing. And we skied at Big Tupper and Lake Placid, and we had a great time. And then we ran into each other a couple years later at a friend's wedding, and he asked me what I was doing. And I was like, oh, I live in Jackson Hole, I'm basically a ski bum. And he was like, oh, that's awesome. I've been thinking about coming out with some friends. And I was like, dude, you know, I can get you 20% off at Jackson Hole's North Lodging. I can show you around, and he did. He came out with like 7 deep, and they had a great time. I think it snowed like a foot in a week. We rallied up some backcountry gear, took them all over, and he loved it. And he did that for a couple years with his friends, and then after that, he just started coming out on his own, sleeping on my couch and burning his vacation days. And at the time, I was working at night, so I'd wake him up every morning at 8 o'clock to go skiing, no matter how late he had stayed up drinking with my friends. and he was always always gay, no matter what. And then at night when I'd go to work, he'd hang out with my friends, and he made some lasting friendships. And about 3 or 4 years ago now, he was supposed to come out on vacation. And you know, usually I pick him up at the airport like a good friend does. And I was calling him a couple times, being like, "Hey, when's your flight come in?" No response. A couple days later, "Hey, when's your flight come in?" Still no response. Like, yeah, that's kind of weird. And then Sunday evening, chilling at home, and it was dark out, it was wintertime, you know. And dog starts barking, and there's a strange truck in the driveway. I'm like, "Whose truck is that?" Sure enough, Luddy opens the door, full of energy and excitement, is like, "I'm here." And I was like, "What do you mean you're here?" He's like, "Packed up the truck and quit my job." He's like, "I'm right now." I'm right now Ethan's extra room for the winter. So I'm here. And that was kind of the start of it. He rented a condo in the village for a couple of months and was a true ski bum. And after that, he already had some lasting friendships that he capitalized on, and played hockey and got a job, and met Sam, I think, by his birthday, April 7th. They were already she was planning his birthday. And I was like, all right, this is awesome. And can't say more like how happy I am for them that they found each other. And Luddy's one of my best friends. You know, when he first started coming out here, I was kind of the one showing him the ropes. He trusted me to make sure the slopes were safe and that we weren't doing anything that we shouldn't be doing. But the tables have turned a few times for sure. He saved my ass on a snowmobile adventure a year or two ago. He's one of my best friends. And I love him dearly, but I love Sam as well. And super happy for him, so cheers to Sam.
Not yet. You guys ready?
Yeah, we're ready. Let's do this.
Got here.
Let's see if this works. Welcome, everybody. Today we're gathered here to celebrate a very special day. Today is going to be the first day for Samantha and Christopher in their new lives. Before we begin, Sam and Chris personally want to thank all in attendance for their love and support and their friendship. They also want to remember grandparents who could not make it here today, Helen Gordon, Edna Bierken, as well as those who passed away, Ken Gordon, Mary Lou and Ed Danahy, William Ellis, Ellie and Duke Ludwig. Oh, this paper's gone. as all as you guys know, it takes a tremendous amount of work to put a day today together. And I think it makes it very special for Chris and Sam that they have so many friends and family here to celebrate with them. So we're going to begin today with a reading. Today's reading is going to be started by Alden Foss.
This reading is called The Blessing of the Hands. These are the hands of your best friend, young and strong and full of love for you, that are holding yours on your wedding day as you promise to love each other today, tomorrow, and forever. These are the hands that will work alongside yours as together you build your future. These are the hands that will love you and cherish you through the years, and with the slightest touch will comfort you like no other. These are the hands that will hold you when fear or grief fills your mind. These are the hands that will countless times wipe the tears from your eyes, tears of sorrow, and as in today, tears of joy. These are the hands that will tenderly hold your children, the hands that will help you hold your family as well. These are the hands that will give you strength when you need it. And lastly, these are the hands that even when wrinkled and aged, will still be reaching for yours, still giving you the same unspoken tenderness with just a touch. Bless these hands that you see before you this day. May they always be held by one.
Before we get to the vows, I'd like to take a minute to share a little bit about Sam and Chris, how they met, and why I personally know their love's going to endure. We're going to start with Sam. As many of you know, Sam has resided in Wyoming for quite some time now. While she has roots on the East Coast, Jackson's clearly her home. It's safe to say that Jackson has been very good to her. As many of her friends would describe her, she's very opinionated, not in a bad way. She knows what she wants and she goes after it. She always makes you feel like she's on your team. Once you're a friend, she would truly do anything for you. She's a great partner and teammate in life. She's also incredibly fun and helps to bring that out in Chris. Chris is of course fun as well, but they complement each other well. Sam is the talker in the relationship. While we all know Chris is involved, listening, and has an opinion, Sam generally makes her opinion known a bit quicker, at which point Chris is generally smirking and possibly enjoying whiskey. You can tell a lot about people from their friends, and that's so true about Chris and Sam. They both have close networks of friends. They'd both do anything for their friends, and yet they find time for each other. All of us love spending time with them. The only time when their friends may possibly finish second is when it comes to Dexter. And Sam, this is kind of off script, but having spent the last few days here, I know you didn't want me to say it. You're a wonderful person.
Thank you.
You really are. And now for Chris. In 2012, Chris made a very difficult decision to leave his job in the finance world of 14 years on the East Coast and move to Jackson Hole. Upon first glance, this seemed like a fairly rash decision. A few of us in attendance may have even told him such. He had a successful career going, a great social life, and his family was really close by. He was also incredibly handy and would do anything for his friends, which added a hint of judgment to his decision, especially in my eyes. Chris, however, loved skiing, the outdoors, adventure, and subsequently Jackson seemed like a perfect fit. Many of us thought this fit might be temporary. Many of us were actually kind of hoping it would be temporary. After the first season in Jackson, he let us all know he was coming home for the summer. Several of us thought, this is it. He enjoyed Jackson, but he's coming home. Chris's visit, however, came with one singular tagline. I'm coming home and you have to meet Sam. I'd never heard Chris so emphatic about anyone or ensuring everyone met someone. It was this point I realized that home might no longer be the metropolis of Connecticut for Chris. And when I met Sam, I knew immediately Chris, his new home was going to be wherever Sam was. Chris constantly described Sam as so cool. He once even told me she was rad, which was literally the first time I'd heard that word since riding a school bus. But when I met Sam, I really did know what he meant. Sam was outgoing and fun, but at the same time smart and independent, and of course beautiful. She could walk into a room of strangers and make friends with everyone. She shared Chris's passion for skiing in the outdoors, and she of course loved Jackson. Sam and Chris seemed perfect for each other in 2012, and that's why we are all so happy to be here in 2015. At this time, I'd like to offer you both some advice on marriage and life moving forward. Once you're married, life is no longer about where you are or what you're doing. Life is solely about who you're with. You will have differences of opinion. Trust me, ask anyone who's married, you will. It's inevitable. But take a moment and forget about what you're doing, why you're doing it, and where you are. And just remember who you are with that is all that really matters. There will certainly be more lows than highs, but celebrate the good times. Remember who you're with, and what is really important in life is that you guys are together. So every day, take a few seconds and appreciate each other. You're gonna make a wonderful married couple. At this time, we're gonna have Genevieve's cousin come up for a reading.
So a couple years ago, Chris saw this reading in my house and liked it, and Sam always remembered this and asked me to read it for his opinion. Edward Abbey's one final paragraph of advice. Don't burn yourselves out. Be as I am, a reluctant enthusiast, a part-time crusader, a half-hearted fanatic. Save the other half of yourselves and your lives for pleasure and adventure. It's not enough to fight for the land. It's even more important to enjoy it while you can, while it's still here. So get out there and hunt and fish and mess around with your friends, ramble out yonder and explore the forests. Encounter the grizz, climb the mountains, bag the peaks, and run the rivers. Breathe deep with that sweet, lucid air. Sit quietly for a while and contemplate the precious stillness, that lovely and mysterious and awesome space. Enjoy yourselves. Keep your brain in your head, and your head firmly attached to your body. The body active and alive. And I promise you this much. I promise you this one sweet victory over your enemies, over those death-bound people with their hearts in a safe deposit box and their eyes hypnotized by death calculators. I promise you this. You'll outlive the bastards.
Chris, do you promise Samantha that from this day onward, you will stand with her in sickness and health, in joy and sorrow, and do you pledge to her your respect and love?
I do.
Samantha, do you promise Chris that from this day onward, you will stand with him in sickness and health, in joy and sorrow, and do you pledge to him your respect and love?
I do.
Okay, repeat after me, okay. Samantha, today we begin our lives together.
Samantha. Today we begin our lives together.
I promise before our friends and family,
to be your faithful husband.
To never take you for granted.
To love you in sickness and health. To cherish all the days of our lives.
I promise you this.
I promise you this.
From my heart.
From my heart.
For all the days of my life.
For all the days of my life.
Ready, Samantha?
I'm ready.
Chris, today we begin our lives together.
Chris, today we begin our lives together.
I promise before our friends and family.
I promise before our friends and family.
To be your faithful wife.
To be your faithful wife.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Good.
To never take you for granted.
To never take you for granted.
To love you in sickness and health.
To love you in sickness and health.
To cherish all the days of our lives.
To cherish all the days of our lives.
Not done yet. I promise you this.
I promise you this.
From my heart.
From my heart.
For all the days of my life.
For all the days of my life.
Just get the rings, buddy.
Both.
Yeah, I'll take both. Chris. What's that? It's okay. It's okay. So you want to put that on her hand? Yeah. Ready? These rings symbolize your bond and matrimony. In the presence of friends and family, seal your promises with these rings. Chris, right? Samantha, I give you this ring.
Samantha, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my love.
Symbol of my love.
And as a constant reminder.
As a constant reminder.
That I have chosen you.
I have chosen you.
Above all others.
Above all others.
To be the one to share my life with.
To be the one to share my life with. Fantastic.
Yes, get it. Chris, I give you this ring.
Chris, I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my love.
As a symbol of my love.
And a constant reminder.
And a constant reminder.
That I have chosen you.
That I have chosen you.
Above all others.
Above all others.
To be the one.
To be the one.
To share my life with.
To share my life with.
You guys ready?
Yeah, we're ready.
Samantha and Christopher, because you've pledged your love and commitment to each other in front of your friends and family and witnesses, I now pronounce you husband and wife. You make us. Congratulations, guys.
All right.
You're awesome.
All right.
Now, I'll go. Yeah. You guys ready?
Yeah. I'd like to thank everybody for coming this evening. I know a lot of you have come a long way. It's quite a tribute to Samantha and Chris that you're here. And I'd like to thank Samantha and Chris on behalf of Sue and myself for planning this wonderful event, and also for all of the events that have been taking place over the past week. It's been a lot of fun. We very much appreciate it. And speaking of Chris and I met probably 2.5 years ago when Samantha brought him to Florida for a vacation. And then we got a chance to spend some time again last spring when we were on a vacation again with the family. As you know, Chris is not a man of many words. And I didn't really have an opportunity to get to know him on a one-to-one basis. But for the most part, the time I spent with him, I found him to be an affable guy. Of course, then when he called me, which was very nice, to ask me for Samantha's hand in marriage in January, I immediately said, "I'll get back to you." it was mentioned by the celebrant at the service that Chris has quite a few friends, many of whom I've had an opportunity to speak with this week, and also have been able to hear give toasts to the wedding. And it's very obvious that Chris and his friends are fiercely loyal to one another, and to my way of thinking, the measure of a man is in his friends. So, Chris, you're definitely playing to.
Hear, hear.
Now on to Samantha. I have three daughters. Samantha is my oldest daughter. I know the conversations and toasts and at the ceremony have spoken to her being somewhat opinionated, possibly blunt. If you want to know if he really likes you, Samantha is your go-to girl for the answer, but she may also tell you he's a loser. You want to know, ladies, if you want to know if these pants are too big or make your butt look too big, Samantha is again your go-to girl. She also may tell you the layout that she's in pepperoni. I like to think of Samantha as not being blunt, but as being forthright. And my first experience with her being forthright was when she was about 2 years old. Her mother and I were trying to get her to potty train, and I can remember she was playing with her toys, and I said, "Come on, honey, you want to go over to the potty?" She looked up at me and said, "I'll go to the potty when I'm damn good." When she was about 4 years old, and she had a touch of the flu, and as her mother and I used to do with our kids when they were sick, one of us would spend the night in the bedroom with them to attend to their needs if they happened to wake up and need some assistance. So at about 4 o'clock in the morning, I'm sound asleep. I get this tap on my shoulder. I open my eyes, and there about 4 inches in front of me is Samantha, who announces, she goes, "Dad, I don't feel well." And then proceeds to unload her dinner from the night before in my face. So, needless to say, I sat up, and when I was able to clear my eyes, I was able to see her. She had gotten back in bed and told me that, "Dad, I feel much better now. It's okay. You can go back to bed." And probably I knew the forthrightness deal was sealed when, I think she was probably 10 or 11, somewhere in there, she said, "Nah, I saw this bumper sticker today. It was really cool." I said, "Well, what did it say?" She said, "It said, lead, follow, or get out of the way." But at any rate, we all know Samantha, and we love her dearly. So I guess my advice to you guys in your marriage is, always have each other's back. Always love each other. Samantha, you're my oldest daughter. You'll always have a special place in my heart.
So what I can hope for Sam and Chris is that, sorry, I'm not going to look at her, because I'm going to look at her. So my hope for Sam and Chris is that they have in each other what I have in Samantha. So in Samantha, I have a best friend. I have, and this is really, really important, especially when you're married, somebody that you can be your true self with. So the good, the bad, the ugly. You don't have to hide anything. You can just kind of let it all hang out. I have a travel buddy. Done a lot of traveling, kind of road trips and all that together. I have someone who I can make oodles of memories with, and then more important than those memories, then we can make fun of ourselves forever, laughing about the memories that we made. The last thing I have in Samantha is I have a sister, the lovely Brooke, okay, and Mary, but I can feel a little portion of her as well. So on this day when Sam and Chris become family, I'm part of that as well. Now, and I also have a steadfast hope for nieces and nephews, not furry ones, and of course I have my little furry Dexter, which is lovely, but so without fur would be great too. So I've been married for 10 years, and I have three little kids, so my marriage advice. I feel like people gave us awful marriage advice. I remember the night we got married, I got married to this little Jamaican lady. Don't ever go to sleep angry. That was terrible advice, okay, in my opinion. Go to sleep. Just like my kids, we get cranky, we get tired. Go to sleep. Start fresh in the morning. Maybe fight again in the morning. Go to sleep. That's really solid advice. Anybody here getting married, solid advice. You need to fight. Fight it out. Like, don't bottle it up. Like, my dad and my stepmom have the greatest marriage. They'll F-bomb each other left and right, and then I'm like, what do you want for dinner? Take time apart, which is selfish on my part because come to New Jersey to visit me. Take time apart. Too much time together is no good. So come to New Jersey often. Sam, my advice to you is just ignore him. Okay, just ignore him. And Chris, my advice for you, will never understand us women. We make no sense. My husband says that we are like Rubik's cubes with no matching colors. So, whatever. Still with it. Just do whatever she says and apologize just all the time. Just all the time. I'm so sorry. You're right. I'm sorry. Okay. So lastly, love. Love with no boundaries. Love when you feel like giving in. Love when hard times hit. Love when kids steal your time, your patience, your sanity, all of your money. Love anyway. They do. Love is a battlefield. You will gain your own scars to prove that it's not easy. But before you surrender your flag, love. Thank you, everybody.
So, good evening. I'm Mike Woods, and I'm one of Chris's friends from childhood as well. Great. Let me begin by saying thank you to Tim, Danny, and Sue Gordon. Awesome night, awesome venue, great time. Thank you very much. Thank you to JP and Cassie. You guys have always been there for us. And trips to the hockey rink, the bikes on our first homes, and renovations, and everything else. Pool parties at 20 Silver String. Trips to Nantucket, everything. You guys seem like you've been hosting for like 30 years. Thank you very much to Chris and Sam for having me up to say something tonight and early before I have the to alcohol combo. I was very lucky to grow up with great family and friends. And most of my childhood memories involve people in this room and sporting events throughout Connecticut and the surrounding area. And it's not a hockey memory without the Lovies. Captain runs the rink, shoulder to say. JP was a coach. Morgan and Griffin were running around the rink raising hell. Just awesome memories. Chris was a great player. And he was 5'8", 125 pounds, 16. And those are like media guy numbers, so 10%. On January 28th, 1995, in a collision against a guy from West Hill, he broke his neck. And he ended up being in a hospital and traction for weeks and then months in a halo brace. And I think it was at that time that the guys who were here from Wilton and whatever saw just how driven he was to come back and kind of get back on the ice a year later. We were all like, wow, this kid really just got it. So that was huge. And I've used that story a dozen times over the last 20 years. Every time I need motivation or I want to tell somebody else, like, hey, shit's not that bad. Tony's always pushing the limits, and he's always determined to live life to the fullest. So he left us all back east and traded his Gucci loafers for cowboy boots. He chose a great place to live. It's beautiful. He chose a great girl. She's beautiful. And, well done. Awesome. Good job.
I love you. sit when it's gone. In other words, congratulations to all of you.
Okay, so there's a super secret society that all of the male members of the wedding spouses are inducted into, called the Order of the Do-Rag. So, gentlemen, don your rag.
Thank you.
So, you'll notice the high-end monogram. Okay, now, all of you are given temporary license to become members of the Order of the Do-Rag, if you so choose to do so. So, by the power invested in me by Tom O'Brien, Chris, Doc. Well, this is a highly sought after position. And by the way, you do get special discounts at various places, and they will leave the light on for you at Motel 6. Thank you very much.
All right. Is that a hip hop? Come on, y'all. Is that a hip hop? I want to hear it. Is that a hip hop? Is that a hip hop? Y'all ready? Is that a hip hop? They hear it? They hear it to the hip hip hop, you don't stop. Rock rock to the booger, the bang bang, the rhythm to the booger, the beat. Say what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the band, and my friends are gonna try to move your feet. Check it out, see, I am Chris Ludwig, and I'd like to say hello. To the black, to the white, the red, and the brown, the purple, and yellow. But first, I gotta bang bang the rhythm to the boogie. Say up jump the boogie to the bang bang boogie. Let's rock, you don't stop. Rock the rhythm, and it'll make your body rock. And also, oh, you've heard my voice, and I brought two friends along. And next on the mic is my man Hank. Come on, man, sing that song. Check it out on the CAS and the OVA, and the rest is FLY. See, I go by the code of the doctor of the mix, and these reasons I'll tell you why. I'm not 6'1", but I've tons of fun, and I dress to a T. See, I got more clothes than Muhammad Ali, and I dress so viciously. That's right, I got bodyguards, I got two big dogs. Definitely ain't the whack. I got a Toyota Tacoma and a Subaru Outback. So after school, I take a dip in the pool, which is really off the wall. I got a color TV so I can see the Knicks play basketball. Hear me talk about checkbook, credit card, more money than a sucker would ever spend. But I wouldn't give a sucker or a Harlem Daily Rock another dime till I made it again. Everybody go hotel, motel. What you gonna do today? Gonna get a fly girl, gonna get some spank and drive off in a demo day. Everybody go hotel, motel, holiday. If your girl starts acting up, then you take her friend. Say, skip, guy, what can I say? I can't fit him all the time, my OJ, so I get tape high and bust him up. I give the rest of messages so he can shock the house. M-A-S, a T-E-R, a G with a double E. Say, go by the unforgettable name of the man I call the Master G. Well, my name is known all over the world by all the foxy ladies and the pretty girls. I'm going down in history as the whitest little rapper that you ever did see. Feeling the highs and you're feeling the lows. Your beat starts stumping into your toes. You start snapping your fingers and stomping your feet and moving your body while you're sitting in your seat. And damn, start doing the freak. I said, damn, right out of your seat now. You throw your hands high in the air. Rock it to the beat, secondary air. You rock it to the beat without a care. With a show shot, MC's 40th fair. Now, I'm not as tall as the rest of the gang, but I rock to the beat just the same. I got a fat face and a pair of brown eyes. All I'm here to do, ladies, is hypnotize. Singing on and on and on and on and on. Beat don't stop until the break of dawn. Singing on and on, on and on and on. Look, I hop in a bop, the bop, the bop, bitty, bitty, bop, the bop, bop. You don't dare stop. Come alive, Sam, tell me what you got. I guess for now you can take a hunch and find that I am the groom of the bunch. But that's okay, cause I'm kicking stride. Cause all I'm here to do is just wiggle your behind. Singing on and on and on and on. The beat don't stop until the break of dawn. Singing on and on and on and on and on. Rock, rock, girls, get on the floor. Gonna freak you here, I'm gonna freak you there. I'm gonna move you out of this atmosphere. I'm one of a kind and I'll shock your mind. I put the tick, tick, titties in your behind. One, two, three, four, come on, girls. Get on the floor, come alive, y'all. Show me what you got, cause I'm guaranteed to make you rock. One, two, three, four. for? Tell me something, man. What are you waiting for? To the hip hop, the hip it, to the hip it, the hip hip hop. You don't stop rocking to the bang bang boogie. Say up jump the boogie, rhythm to the boogie to beat. Skittle bebop, we rock the Scooby Goo. And guess what, Samantha, I love you. Cause you rock and roll with so much soul. You rock to 101 years old. I don't mean to brag, I don't mean to boast, but I want butter on my breakfast toast. Rock it up, bigger butter. Bang the boogie to the boogie to bang. Bang the boogie to the beat. Beat is so unique. Come on, everybody, and dance to the beat. That's right.
I had like an iPhone on earlier.
And I heard that only.